Hello and welcome to Fixing South Sudan, your ideas for building the new nation. This week, we are bringing to you the report in J1. Yesterday, the government of the Republic of South Sudan, led by the President of the Republic of South Sudan, General Salva Kiir Mayardit, held a consultative meeting at Freedom Hall in Juba to consult the people of South Sudan on the number of states, whether they are for 32 states plus or they are for the other suggested number of states in the Republic of South Sudan. Today, the 15th of February 2020, the president gave his position as the government of the Republic of South Sudan on the number of states. And the final declared number of states for the Republic of South Sudan is 10 states plus 3 administrative areas in the Republic of South Sudan. President Salva Kiir said this is for the sake of peace in the Republic of South Sudan, to maintain peace in the country, and people should not go back to war again. Thank you so much for watching. Reporting for Dolco Media, I am Ajur Cholkor at J1.
Sir, Sir, Salva Kiir. South Sudan, way. South Sudan, way. Ten said, way. South Sudan, way. SPLM, way. Salva Kiir, way. Let me continue. Let me repeat to 10 states and their previous respective counties, plus 3 administrative areas, namely Abia administrative area, 2 Ruweng administrative area, and 3 the Greater Pibor administrative area. 3, recognize that this decision may not have been the best option for our people, but for the sake of peace, unity in the country, the presidency sees it necessary. Ayatnak, Ayatnak.
Ayatnak, Ayatnak.
Five, the presidency has taken note of those who will be affected by these changes, and therefore some arrangements have been made to been put in place to address their concern. Six, decided to remain seized of the matter, and hereby directs the Minister of Justice and Constitutional Affairs to effect these changes, these legal changes, with immediate effect. The end of the communique. Thank you, Your Excellencies. It is my pleasure to welcome His Excellency Dr. James Wanyiga, the Vice President of the Republic, to give you a few remarks. Your Excellency, you are welcome.
SPLM, oh yeah. At the parties, come on, oh yeah. At the parties, oh yeah. Your Excellency, the President of the Republic, General Kiir Mayardit, Your Excellency, the first Vice President, General Taban Dengai, the right honorable speaker, the August gathering. Good morning, comrades, to all of you. Salaam alaikum. First of all, I would like to congratulate those of you who have attended from the beginning to the end, the marathon meeting of Freedom Hall yesterday. I would like to congratulate you for that work. Nagulekum Badu Sukran for the efforts that you have exerted yesterday. I also would want to congratulate the President of the Republic for convening this morning very important briefing and an address to our people that will follow. As mentioned yesterday, when I went to close that meeting of the Freedom Hall, the meeting of today, this particular one, is to hear a resolution of the presidency, following it also marathon meeting yesterday. And this is precisely the resolution Honorable Maik has just read to the spirit and letter. And we all in the presidency agree to that. True, comrades, given the evolution of things, the presidency meeting was very necessary. After thorough discussion and deeply looking into the concerns of our beloved people and country, as well as the concerns of the entire international community, because we are not an island, by the way, and the concerns of the region, we came up with this historic resolution, which I'm sure will usher the progress and peace in our country. And at this juncture, our country actually, comrades, needs peace and prosperity, including unity, more than anything else. I know that this may be very disappointing to some of our people, as we admitted in the resolutions. But these are tough times. Times when you must take decisions. Decisions which might be contrary to the aspirations of some of your people. But as a leader, you must take the correct decision. When the walking becomes rough and tough, you must hold the bull by the horns. And this is the rough time. And so, I ask, you are here representing the leadership of our government, leadership of the SPLM, and leadership of other political parties, different categories. I ask this August House to firmly stand firm for this resolution. To stand firm with this resolution. This is the best way out of the current crisis. As already mentioned in the resolution and mentioned yesterday by His Excellency the President in the Freedom Hall, once we are together in that government, the revitalized Tigonu, we can talk about niceties, even if it means raising the number to 50, why not? But not at the time when our boat, the boat of South Sudan, is shaky. It will be a serious miscalculation on our side. And we are being driven by nothing but patriotism for our people and country, bearing the fact that it is only peace and peace and peace that can take us forward. Nothing else. We can have the 32 states, but in midst of dust, that will bury a lot of our poor people and children. And what do we benefit at the end? Pride comes before a doom. We will surely not be happy. We will even regret that base kalam walayat, which we can decree anytime. Malo. So the principal concerns which our people really need to know are those who may find themselves displaced. But it's not a real displacement that you may think. Call it a transfer from one position to another. Absolutely. Was it not Dr. John, but actually it is the Bible, who said there are many rooms in my father's house. And definitely, those of you who are holding constitutional posts and may get displaced, and those of you who are civil servants in different forms and levels, you will definitely get a room to continue your task for nation building and peace building. It is based on this. I don't want to prolong. It is a straightforward decision. But I want you to stand firmly with the presidency, remain united together, remain cooperating, because it is that unity and cooperation that can take us forward. And at this juncture, I call upon the first vice president
and other political parties. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't have much to say, because I think Dr. James have said and he has explained, and the president will come and explain more to the nation why this decision. Tabanze maitu arfin kalamita wilayat katir da matlab shabi matlab ita shabi tana lakin matlab shabi inta mapta hagi gula mana shabi kun magasam anadla mana kun magasamin ma mumkin tasal al haq lil al shab dairo wahed al nas fil awal na wahed al balad fil awal and then badak nasal nafs al sual kif nahkam nafsana zaman dak biji fi zaman salam bitana wa zaman istighrar bitana zai mai to arfin kalam bitana bita sudan zaman bi gulu al khurm al bijib bil hawa sidu istariya al khurm bita wilayat da yablena hawa katir wa garab yadai al balad bitana nahna nasidu wa nartah سيد الرئيس انا بقول لك مبروك الف مبروك مبروك لنا وانا ما عندي حاجه كثير بمشي فوقه may you come your excellency and address the nation. Thank you.
Your excellency General Tabandengai, first vice president of the Republic of South Sudan. His Excellency Dr. James Wani Iga, Vice President of the Republic of South Sudan. Right Honorable Speaker of the National Legislature, Honorable Presidential Advisors, Honorable Ministers, compatriots, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank each and every one of you for attending this important meeting to brief you on the decision reached by the presidency yesterday in regard to the number of states, which has just been read out to you by the minister in the office of the president. As we gathered here today, as the transitional government of national unity, I want to remind ourselves of the sacrifices that our martyrs made to liberate this country. And for that reason, we are bound to take any decision that is deemed necessary to preserve the unity of our country. By doing so, it signifies that their precious blood was not just shed in vain. This decision was reached by the presidency after weighing several options, and we thought this latest compromise will preserve the unity of the country and move the people of South Sudan out of this imposed, senseless conflict, which has affected the livelihoods of many of our citizens. For the last 6 years, we must put a stop to this suffering because our people deserve the best. For those for close to 2 years now since the signing of the revitalized agreement, the opposition forces have been holding our country to ransom because of the issue of states, although this was not the reason why they took up arms against the government in 2013. For such unnecessary demand, we have not been able to form the government as stipulated in the agreement. Two deadlines have already been missed, and another one on February 22nd is looming. Yet our people continue to suffer due to intransigence of the opposition. I am aware that there are some people who may think that we have relented to the pressure of the opposition. But this is not true, because we realized the goal of the opposition is to ensure the country remains unstable in order to continue putting the blame on the government. Comrades, ladies and gentlemen, the compromise we have made today is one of the painful decisions I have ever made, but it is necessary. But it is necessary if that is what will bring back peace and preserve the unity of our people. I have been fighting throughout my entire life for the liberation of this country. And I will always stand against the forces that aspire to destroy our hard-won sovereignty. I will not accept to preside over the destruction of the same country that I sacrificed to liberate. The insistent demand to return the country to 10 states is a strategy of the people who do not wish us good but more suffering and destruction. My decision today will throw out such ill intentions and make us resilient against their mischievous plans. We were in the 10 states when the war started in 2013, and that attests to the fact that the cause of this conflict was not about the states, but mere greed for political power. Comrades, ladies and gentlemen, I call upon all of you, the citizens of this country, especially those who may not be comfortable with this decision, to accept it and rally behind your government. To implement the revitalized agreement, we should refocus our energies to the unity of the country so that the peace agreement that we are going to implement reunites our people once again and gives us the opportunity to collectively embark on the nation building. As liberators of this country, we should always take decisions that are in the best interest of our people and the country, to the best interest of our people and the country. And this is what I have done today. And as you have read in our resolution, the issue of the number of states will be addressed by a revitalized transitional government of national unity during the implementation period. We will make sure that the people of South Sudan are accorded an opportunity to exercise their rights in determining the number of states that they need in the country. Yani, ya jama kalam betul walaya de haja basit jiden. Nahnu gidamna anamol constitution. In that constitutional process, we can determine the number of states. And also, you know, after the election, should that come after the elections, these conditions of confining us to conflict will not be there any longer. And we will go back to whatever number of states that we won. Let the people not let their hearts be broken, because 10 states will not cover all the South Sudan. Let us move forward. At this juncture, I would like to commend the security sector for upholding their constitutional mandate of protecting the territorial integrity of the country and maintaining law and order. I further urge them to continue observing the permanent ceasefire as we exert efforts to ensure timely information of the revitalized transitional government of national unity. I implore the international community, particularly the UN, IGAD, AU, EU, and the Troika, to recognize the major compromise that we have just made today. I appeal to them to support the implementation of the agreement, both morally and materially, for without their support, their contributions, we may not be able to meet the daunting task of reviving our economy and set the country on the path of development. Comrades, ladies and gentlemen, the world is watching us. And I once again want to redraw your attention to symbolic prayers conducted by the three Wales Christian leaders during our retreat to Rome in April last year, particularly the action of the Holy Father, Pope Francis, kissing our feet. As I reiterate on a number of occasions, this is a blessing to us if we are sincere in our efforts to reunite our people and salvage them from current suffering. Or it may be a curse if we continue to pursue strategies that endanger the lives of our people. We need to pay attention to this because the curse may not only be upon those whose feet were kissed, but could also be all of us who make decisions on behalf of our people and this country, and so the need to implement the agreement requires our collective consensus and efforts to resist the temptation of going back to war. Comrades, I can't end these opening remarks without equally appealing to our brothers and sisters who are still holding out to come and join us on this journey of reuniting the country. The compromise we have just made is in the interest of peace, and the quest for peace should not be one-sided. I expect the opposition to reciprocate the same and allow the country to move forward. Thank you very much.